Before we proceed, I would like to call upon Professor Hashim Kamali to give a welcoming remarks.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to IAIS, everyone. And our guest of honor today, Professor Dr. Jasser Auda, who is not the first time to be here with us. We have been together on similar events, in fact, with the participation of ABIM, we are working together, in fact, on a continual basis. Today's subject is Maqasid in the challenges facing the youth. I think everyone will agree that the youth represent the energy and the vitality of every society, past and present. And I think that should be obvious and self-evident without further elaboration. The fact that in the past, the youth have not been as visible as they are today may have been a function of other factors, like the media, for example, were at a lower level, the family structure, traditional society, respect for the parents and culture, and so on. But with the advent of globalization, the youth became exposed to so many different influences that were not there in the past. In the borderless world today, in fact, the youth are perhaps the most active and dynamic element. Their exposure level, sometimes they are referred to as the digital natives, most at ease with the means of communication, active in social media. But also, I think their interest and participation level in what happens in the society at large. Most recent, the Arab Spring was a youth movement, in fact, and not just that, but before that, the Islamic revivalist movement in the MENA region, Asia, in the Middle East, they were really propelled by the youth, their participation in Iran, Afghanistan, and in the Arab world has been quite evident, increasingly so. They have been an agent of change, and I think that there are some new additional factors which add to the significance of that participatory role. One is the increased levels of youth participation in their eye-catching success in the education sector, their participation in the employment, and also increasingly the governments are recognizing this. Although this is one of the challenges, the youth are still, this is their general feeling that they are being marginalized. They are not giving enough opportunity to participate in decision making. You and I know that most of the time people in important positions, ministers, even recently, only recently we have seen some younger faces in the cabinets, but traditionally this was not the case. Also in the corporate sector, the older people dominated decision-making processes, but now their presence and there the level of exposure, education, I think they're perhaps the maturity factor is also, I think our youth are nowadays, you speak to them, the level of maturity that they show, they exhibit is quite impressive. We had one event recently, some youth from Malaysia spoke there. I think I was quite impressed. unemployment is another area where the youth are participating in very large numbers, and yet there are challenges. I think the figures tell us in any, in Muslim societies in the MENA region, 24 to 26% of youth are unemployed. This is far above the average level of unemployment. In Malaysia, we don't have much unemployment, but the youth unemployment level is quite high, probably 20%. What are the reasons? Perhaps they are not all economic. The youth are selective. They are also active in setting up their own businesses. Sometimes we hear that their softer skills need to be upgraded. Their maybe expertise is education level is okay, but how they adapt to the work environment, those are some of the factors that are highlighted. But the society has, the traditional society itself has changed with the advent of globalization. The closed society is now changed into an open society, the borderless world and countries that we are having today. That exposes all of us, in the youth especially, to these different, sometimes disconcerting influences. I think secularity, modernization, and other influences of, materialist culture, the youth have their own lifestyle, their culture, for example, their fashion consciousness, the dress, the noise they make, for example. At the university, the youth that you meet are not the same as you might expect, traditional Muslim societies, the youth behaving somewhat differently with their teachers. No, this is a different encounter, a different attitude. We do not really desire all of them. I think that we should have our own grounding in our own value system, and this is perhaps one of the more the greater challenges, how to keep our contact, the youth society, grounded in Islamic values. And I think that the Maqasid, when we speak of Maqasid, especially of the essential Maqasid, the Daruriyat, protection of religion, of life, of intellect, of property and family. These are some of the values, not all, that Islam stands for, that will protect them at all costs. And these are not one at a time. They must be protected and promoted all at the same time. And that means that a balanced attention to all of these priorities, and that Islam does not only address the older people and not only any sector, one sector of society, all of us together. If the Maqasid are addressed to the Muslims, they are equally addressed to the youth. Attention to these values is a matter of priority for Muslims. And a priority aspect of Islamic teachings, what it means to be grounded in these values, I think that our society is not always in tune with a lot of these, and that is the challenge, not just for youth, but for societies that are driven by the factors of secularity in materialist culture and so on. For all of us, we have this advice, but I think more so for the youth. And I think that attention to the family, attention to the softer aspect of, you know, what it means to be a good Muslim, a good person, a good family person, and a healthy agent for change in society. These are, in fact, the values Islam stands for, the Maqasid speak for them, and that is for all of us. But I think my purpose here is not to address this subject in a great at length. I just thought I'll make a few introductory remarks, but then thank you very much. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam rahmatullahi barakatuh. Thank you, Prof. Kamali. I think it is not only a welcoming remark, but also some of the tazkirah for Jumaat pagi, for the youth. let us welcome Brother Muhammad Faisal Abdul Aziz, Secretary General of the ABIM, to give welcoming remarks.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi ta'ala wabarakatuh. Alhamdulillahi nahmadu wa nasta'inu wa nasta'hdi wa nasta'gfiruh. Wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyati amalina. Man yahdihillah fala mudilla lah. ومن يضلل هادي الله اشهد ان لا اله الا الله وحده لا شريك له واشهد ان محمدا عبده ورسوله. Distinguished guests, Dr. Jasser Auda, respected Deputy CEO of International Advance of Islamic Studies, Professor Dr. Muhammad Adil, respected co-chairman of IAIS, Professor Dr. Hashim Kamali, and members of the floor. Today it is an honor for Muslim Youth Movement Malaysia ABIM to once again collaborate with International Advance of Islamic Studies IAIS to conduct this fruitful intellectual discourse with Dr. Jasser Auda. And Dr. Jasser, as you know, has shared, always shared his views with regards to on how we perceive Shari'ah by emphasizing more on the objective of the Shari'ah or Maqasid al-Shari'ah rather than Shari'ah itself with the spirit of contextualization and locality. And on behalf of Muslim Youth Movement Malaysia ABIM, we would like to thank Professor Dr. Muazzam for his effort to conduct this remarkable event. And Dr. Muazzam is an example of an open-minded intellectual. We subscribe the idea of inclusiveness, who always gets all quarters, especially ABIM, to be part on his intellectual effort. And my special thanks as well to Professor Dr. Hashim Kamali, the person whom I don't have to introduce. And of course, the famous author of the famous book, The Principles of Islamic Jurisprudence. I think it is not fair to mention his name without mentioning his book due to the great ideas of intellectual in the field of academics. Some students, especially students, sometimes know about his book more than him himself. And having said so, by organizing this event, it is hoped it will expose to the Malaysian society, especially Malaysian youth, on the contemporary and fresh talk of Islamic studies in the field of Islamic knowledge. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you very much, Brother Muhammad Faisal, for that indeed good remarks. I think it is an honor for IAIS if I were to continue through that work along with the youth, especially with ABIM, in enhancing this ummah in this knowledge. Just before I pass the mic to Professor Jasser Auda, I think you have the CV or profile of Prof. Jasser Auda in your program, but this one is the latest input that I just got it from Prof. Jasser Auda, and I need to mention this. Dr. Jasser Auda is also a visiting professor at Carleton University in Canada, and now he's a director of Maqasid Institute based in London. This is something updated from what we have in our program. Without further ado, I would like to welcome Professor Jasser Auda to share with us on this topic, Maqasid al-Shari'ah and the challenges facing the Muslim youth.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, alhamdulillah, hamdan kathiran, tayyiban, mubarakan fi, barakan alayhi kama yuhibbu rabbuna wa yarda, wa salatu wa salamu ala Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa tabi'in ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين ثم أما بعد. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. It is such a privilege and an honor to be here once again. This time not coming by myself, coming with my wife and talking about the youth, something that we as parents face, having children in different ages and having challenges in different ages. The challenges of the 20s and the challenges of the teenagers, and each bracket of the children have different challenges. I do not have answers for the questions that the youth have. I sometimes myself am challenged by the challenges that the youth have, and therefore this lecture I will really have to be humble approaching this topic. Not speaking of authority, I could speak inshallah of some authority on Maqasid al-Shari'ah. I use Maqasid al-Shari'ah in fatwa and ijtihad, and I write about Usul and sometimes about siyasa al-shari'ah and all of these big things. But when it comes to the real life and the real challenges that the youth face, it is a challenge by itself to take the values and the objectives of the Maqasid and try to apply them in real life, try to realize them in one's life. Youth, I always tell the youth to do what they think is right. Whether I am asked by the youth in some Islamic groups or Islamic parties, I'm not talking about Malaysia only, in general, especially in the Arab world, complaining about the gap between them and the older generation, which I think I belong to now. You know, approaching 50 is a funny number. You start to really have no doubt that you're no longer youth. But inshallah, youth is in the heart, as we say in Arabic. So hopefully we... But then there is such a gap between people who are in their 20s and 30s and people who are in their 70s and 80s. Everywhere in the world, especially in the Muslim world, and especially with Islamic movements and Islamic parties and Islamic universities and so on. And we are caught in the middle. The 50s people are caught in the middle between the 20s and the 70s. But the 20s and the 70s, they live in two different planets, totally. You know, they live in two different worlds. And unfortunately, as our Sheikh Dr. Kamali said, unfortunately, they are marginalized to a large extent, and they don't have a say to a large extent. So it's a pleasure to talk about this topic, and I will take less time from my lecture to give more time for the discussion, because I think the discussion is more important. Of course, after thanking Prof. Kamali and Prof. Muazzam and Brother Aziz and all the brothers in ABIM and IAIS, it's a pleasure to be here, and it's an honor to work with you, inshallah, towards something worthwhile for our ummah. I appreciate the intellectual work, especially Prof. Kamali and Prof. Muazzam do, but as we were saying over tea, how the intellectual work that we do could translate into something meaningful for the youth is a challenge by itself. So I will try to approach this challenge with some ideas. The first remark is that whenever youth take over, our ummah goes up. And whenever the elderly take over, our ummah is normally on the decline. And I'm not saying that leadership should have no elderly. Of course, elderly bring wisdom and experience and knowledge, and they are very important. But youth have to be empowered for our ummah to go upwards. It is a fact of life, and despite the fact that, as I was telling you, I find myself getting into the elderly bracket, but the elderly have to be aware that their responsibility for the ummah is to give tamkeen, the empowerment for the youth, for them to take over, to make mistakes, to have very new ideas and very new approaches, and to take our ummah up. And this is not just a theory. This is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you read the seerah and you look for the companions' ages, you will be shocked at how young the companions were when they made these big roles that they played. You know, Sayyidina Ali, when he converted or when he aslam with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was a teenager. He was a teenager, 14, 16. And he and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Abu Bakr, who was not that old at the time, they were an ummah, a bunch of young men. Sayyidina Mus'ab died at the age of 29. After all of what he did, and you read the history of Mus'ab and this, and then all of this was achieved before he turned 30, radiallahu anhu, and he died. If you read about the ages of Sayyidina Khalid and Sayyidina Uthman, and these were young men. Asma, Khawla, etc., Aisha, these were young women, very young, teenagers, when they started to do major things for Islam. Sometimes we look at a teenager as somebody who is not capable of doing major things. And yes, many teenagers are not capable of doing major things. But we need to expect more from the youth, and we need to believe more from the youth. And the more responsibility the youth start to carry, the more learning they will do, and hopefully they will pull our ummah upwards. We, in general, as a Muslim ummah, we are at quite a low point. Looking at the heartland of the Muslim ummah out there in the Arab world and what happens there, and yes, lots of youth are doing lots of things, but many of them are misguided. At the top levels of decision-making and governance and activism and official and non-official work, governmental, non-governmental, society, even in social decisions, you will find people who are much older, who are monopolizing decision and monopolizing governments and leading the heartland of the Muslim ummah to, you know, downwards, very fast, downwards. And it is important for the youth to start to take over. And if they cannot take over from within the system, they should start to be creative. They should start to form their own organizations. I tell my brothers in the Islamic groups, if you cannot change the Islamic group and you have this overwhelming willingness to change and overwhelming different view, then form another group and let it take its path and its history. You don't have to work from within the groups. If you cannot change the university, if you cannot change the company, if you cannot change the NGO, form another one. And just go and register a company and start your own work. Don't work as your father wants you to work or your grandfather wants you to work, and the company is going down, and they insist on the company going down. Don't work as the elderly in the Islamic groups want you to work, and the group is going down, and everybody, Islam is going down with them. And they still insist on the old ways of doing things. So I tell the youth, well, form other groups. And that could be one of the ways of dealing with the challenge of unemployment and the challenge of marginalization, is for you, young man or woman, to employ yourself and to make yourself an entrepreneur and form your own group and form your own association. If the old associations are not going to include the youth, as we have here, I'm optimistic about IAIS, I'm optimistic about the organizations that I see that includes the youth, because now the blood will be renewed naturally. But if the organization does not allow the youth to have any role, then the organization will fall. And organizations are not divine, they are not holy. They will Any university could have a lifetime and end. Any Islamic group or Islamic party could have a lifetime and end. Nothing will remain forever. But what will remain forever is the university, Islamic group, Islamic association, company that is able to renew itself and pump new blood and new ideas and youth in its leadership and its decision-making, serious decision-making, not just lip service. I see a lot of lip service to the youth, and we are a youthful ummah. All of the tyrants in the Arab world say that. We are a youthful nation, and we give the youth, and they take all of these selfies with the youth. But the youth have no say. And if they say no, they go to prison. And if they say no a bit louder, they are killed in the street. And this is the case in the Arab world in general. And alhamdulillah, the wider Muslim world is a bit more wiser than the Arab world in the current stage. But still, the youth are largely marginalized from what I see in the Islamic activism and the Islamic universities and the Islamic movements in general. It is important to remember how the companions of Allah anhum pulled the ummah up by new ideas and sometimes taking risks and dreaming big. And what they dream today is what they will achieve as reality tomorrow. So how can Maqasid al-Shari'ah help the youth? To me, Maqasid al-Shari'ah are the values of Islam. They are, of course, the objectives of the Sharia, the meanings, the purposes, the ends that the Sharia is trying to achieve in the society. And in way of introduction, we can talk about darurat wa hajiyat wa tahsiniyat, essentials and needs and luxuries, and all of this the Sharia is trying to achieve in a society. Essentials, the preservation of life, the preservation of faith, preservation of family, dignity, intellect, preservation of property, all of the masalih, or the good that is in the society. This is not the only theory of maqasid. Maqasid include other values, Islamic values. Mercy is a maqsid, justice is a maqsid, wisdom is a maqsid, common good, at-taysir, facilitation, and having a good life is a maqsid. There are so many maqasid that you can read about, or it's not my topic, but my topic is how these values could become a reality in the youth's life so that they can face their challenges. And I have a few ideas that I will touch on briefly, and then I will leave the discussion to, inshallah, cover the points, the important points, really, of the topic. Number one idea is that if you look at maqasid, or objectives, your objective has to be Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is number one way of facing the challenges, and number one tool of facing your challenges. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is your maqsid, is your maqsood, is your objective, you are trying to do things for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you are directing your life as a young man or woman towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you are applying maqasid al-shari'ah in a major way. Everything else is tools and means and roads towards that objective. I'm directing my objective towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because at the end, this life is something that will pass, and we will return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we would like, when we return, to be in a good shape and for Allah to give us Jannah. So this is an essential part of the Islamic aqidah that should materialize into a feeling first and action. Every time I do an action, I have Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as my ultimate objective. That is very important. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is your ultimate objective, you will see the wisdom in the challenges you face. Because not every challenge you face is bad. In fact, every challenge you face is good. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, عَجَبًا لِأَمْرِ الْمُؤْمِنِ إِنَّ أَمْرَهُ كُلَّهُ لَهُ خَيْرٌ إِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ سَرَّاءَ شَكَرْ فَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُ وَإِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ ضَرَّاءَ صَبَرْ فَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُ. I am amazed, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, by the believer. Ajaban, I am amazed. Everything that comes to the believer is good. If Allah gives him khair, or good,
then he or she is thankful and it is good. And if Allah gives him darra, harm or hurting or pain or challenge, then he is patient and it is good. So if you have Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as the objective, then everything is good and everything is fine. And if you have good things that you have in life, then this is good because you will thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you will try to use that good for the bigger good. And if you feel something is harmful or hurtful or challenging or difficult or painful somehow, then you know also it's good because you're learning patience, you're learning sabr, you're learning yaqeen. And sabr, the patience and yaqeen and deep belief is what will make you a leader. وَجَعَلْنَا مِنْهُمْ أَئِمَّةً يَهْدُونَ بِأَمْرِنَا لَمَّا صَبَرُوا وَكَانُوا بِآيَاتِنَا يُوقِنُونَ. Allah is talking about the children of Israel, and He is saying that we made them leaders when they had patience and deep belief. Patience and deep belief is something that you will not get by reading a book or listening to a lecture. It is something that you will get by facing challenges. And when you face challenges, you have deeper and deeper belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You humble yourself, you try to correct yourself, you try to acquire the skills that you need in order to face the challenge, and you have patience. Patience not to fall in any sin, patience not to complain about your situation, and patience by working hard to change your situation. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the maqsood and the objective, then in the road towards that objective, in the journey towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is no challenge. Everything is good and everything is an opportunity, in fact, to change your situation to a better situation. And then you will approach issues in a very different light when you know that they are gifts and they are not trials, that every trial becomes a gift. So that's idea number one. Idea number two has to do with embracing maqasid as values, as akhlaq, because we have an issue of tadayyun. We have a problem with the way we express a deen in our lives. A tadayyun, or the manifestation of a deen, has challenges here. When you are principled and when you have integrity, then you are more capable of facing the challenges. And these principles are the maqasid. The maqasid are not just objectives of the law. They are akhlaq, they are ethical values. When we talk about justice, justice is not just the objective of the system or the goal of the policy. Justice is a khuluq. Justice is something that I have in my heart. So when I deal with people, I deal with justice. Justice is about balancing the opposite and managing diversity and dealing with people who have push and pull in a way that tries to balance things. So when I deal financially with people, I have to be just and fair, and I have to give people their dues. If I deal in a family matter or a social matter or a relationship, whatever it is, brother, sister, husband, wife, etc., co-workers, I have to have justice as a value. But justice without a very other important value is not enough. The other value is mercy. Justice and mercy. Ibn al-Qayyim says, "Al-Shari'atu adlun kulluha wa rahmatun kulluha." It's not only justice, but it's also mercy. When the Quran talks about issues like the hudud or issues like the financial dealings or any of the issues, you will find the word mercy or the word pardon or the word tolerance, al-afu, al-rahma, وَأَن تَعْفُوا أَقْرَبُ لِلتَّقْوَى. So it is not only justice and it's not only a dry dealing that I deal with people, but mercy. And in fact, mercy is one of the higher values of Islam. I have to be able to sympathize with the poor in order to alleviate myself from poverty. I have to be able to sympathize with the orphans in order to be able to myself stand on my feet. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he talked about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the way Muhammad grew up sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, والضحى والليل إذا سجى ما ودعك ربك وما قلى ولا الآخرة خير لك من الأولى. ألم يجدك يتيما فآوى ووجدك ضالا فهدى ووجدك عائلا فأغنى. Didn't he see you, find you as an orphan, and he gave you shelter? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Muhammad shelter as an orphan. Muhammad was an orphan, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَوَجَدَكَ ضَالًا فَهَدَى. Didn't he find you seeking knowledge or lost? Didn't he find you lost and he guided you? وَوَجَدَكَ عَائِلًا فَأَغْنَى. Didn't he find you poor and he gave you wealth? And then the rest of the surah says, فَأَمَّا الْيَتِيمَ فَلَا تَقْهَرْ. Therefore, the orphan do not mistreat. Why? Because you were an orphan. You know how it feels to be an orphan. And from your orphan experience, you are able to appreciate orphan. فَأَمَّا الْيَتِيمَ فَلَا تَقْهَرْ وَأَمَّا السَّائِلَ فَلَا تَنْهَرْ. You were lost and you were not guided. But you know what it means to be guided and to see the light and to have knowledge. And therefore, people who come to you asking for knowledge, وَأَمَّا السَّائِلَ فَلَا تَنْهَرْ. People who come to you ask for knowledge, then give them knowledge kindly and nicely, because you were in their position one day. وَأَمَّا بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِّثْ. And talk to people or demonstrate. Hadith is more demonstrate to people the blessing of Allah on you. Give the poor, take care of yourself, take care of your family, etc. You were poor and you became rich, and therefore take care of the poor. You were an orphan and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you shelter and gave you people to support you. Therefore, take care of the orphans and the weak. And you were lost and you didn't have any guidance, and Allah gave you guidance. Therefore, take care of people who are ignorant and they come and ask for guidance. And that is the journey that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went through in order to have the values of the Sharia in his heart, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The value of mercy, the value of generosity, the value of justice, the value of wisdom and peace and reconciliation and facilitation and kindness and all of the values of Islam. It's not only justice, but it's all the other values. So one way to, in a form of theory, and now we can have perhaps more discussions on real issues, but for Maqasid al-Shari'ah to become akhlaq, to become values that you hold in your heart and you act upon, mercy, justice, peace, generosity, facilitation, the preservation of mind, the preservation of family, these are values. These are not only objectives of policies or whatever, but they are also values to preserve one's dignity and people's dignity, to preserve people's minds, and so forth. Another idea, Maqasid al-Shari'ah are the objectives. They are the answer of the question of why. And it is very important to ask why in order to face the challenges properly. Why am I facing this challenge? This is a critical question where you are able to critique the things you did. You are able to critique whatever organization or company or movement or university you are part of. You are able to critique what's happening, the reality on the ground, and you try to change it. Why? Sometimes we are not allowed to ask why. Maqasid al-Shari'ah is one of the ways that teach us to ask why. Because we ask why did Allah send the Sharia? And why is this and why is that? And when we ask why, we open doors for creativity. Because if I have the objective clear, then I can be creative with the means to reach the objective. So why are we making this organization, NGO, that I'm very active with? Why? Well, in order to help the poor in a certain area, or in order to fight for women's rights in a certain form, or in order to have a certain objective. Now, if we have roadblocks and we have obstacles between us and the objective, and we cannot go in a certain way, perhaps we can be creative about the means. We can find other means of reaching the same objectives. Because we ask why. We don't take the day-to-day activism and the day-to-day work for granted. Why am I doing this job? Well, I'm doing this job because the next step, I want to do this. I want to help the society in a certain way. I want to help my family in a certain way. If the job is not achieving your objectives, then you change the job. The job is a means anyway. The road that you take from point A to point B is a means. If the road is blocked, take another road. And this is very important in thinking about the Sharia in one way, but in thinking about everything else, not just the Sharia. Sometimes we need to define the objectives very well, so we are creative with the means. The means are not fixed, usually, unless they're ibadat or something very, you know, obvious. But the means to reach the Islamic objectives are not fixed, and we have to be creative, and that is what the youth could do. The youth, as I said, live in a different planet, and they have very different means at their hands. And they open the internet, and there are so many means to everything that our generation did not have. We did not grow up with this. You have so many means to fundraise for any project. You have so many means to learn about something. We used to travel in order to go to some library to find a book. We still do that, but on the internet you can learn any language, and you can do find information on anything, any statistics you like to find, any. The means you have to be creative with. And once you define your objectives, then the means are flexible, the means are open. You need to be able to think outside the box, because the previous generation thought outside its box, but now they form their own box. They have their own box. Yes, in their heyday, as we say in English, they were very creative and they thought outside the box. But now the box that they thought about in the 60s and 70s and 80s and 90s is a very different box from the box of today. You need to think outside the box and make your own norms and your own creativity. And therefore, we need to ask why. And when we ask why, then we know as well what is right and what is wrong. When you travel somewhere, people are traveling from here, I'm hearing, to go and fight in the Middle East, which is, like, to me, it's amazing. It's out of this world. Well, like, but can't they ask themselves why? Why? Why are you leaving a country like this where you can do so much for Islam, and you go and fight in a dirty war where everybody is a loser there, except for, you know, people with atomic power and all of that? Don't you ask why? And when you ask why, you are able to rationalize your decisions. You cannot just be amazed by some photo on a screen or some Hollywood-style kind of movie, and you go and lose your life, and then you get involved, as you hear from the youth over there, you got involved in murder and theft and crime. You become a criminal. Why? Why do you do that? You're a good Muslim, you know. So the asking of why, to rationalize some of the decisions that the young men and women make, is very important. Another idea that has to do with maqasid as priorities. The maqasid sharia thinking is a thinking that prioritizes what is important and what is less important. And why do we need to prioritize? Because we have limited resources. We have limited money, we have limited effort, we have limited time. So when we are active in a certain field, in a certain area, we need to sit down and prioritize. What project should we start with first? What manner should we correct first? What mistake in the society should we correct first? What mistake even about myself? If I want to make myself a better person, what should I start with first? What is the priority? Maqasid al-Shari'ah gives you that idea because it differentiates between the necessities and the means and the luxuries. It differentiates between the things that are essential and general and very important for the ummah and things that are individualistic and personal and small. It is very important when we face the challenges to prioritize. And as an ummah, and I find a lot of the youth, we are involved in so much wasted effort and time and money over very small issues, over mundane issues. The mundane issues, the small, the tiny issues, are the issues that dominate the debate. People in parliaments debate tiny issues, even though the parliament is a legislative body, is supposed to make laws for the solving the problems of the society. I'm not talking about here only, everywhere. After the quote-unquote, big quotes, revolution that we had in the Arab world in 2011, we had parliaments and parties, Islamic parliaments and Islamic parties, and people elected some of the Islamic groups. And then when the party started to function, you could be shocked at how tiny the issues are. You know, in a place where people are dying from hunger and people have all sorts of social, economic, and ethical problems, major ones, gangs in the streets, drugs by the billions of dollars worth of trade, and then a parliament sits down and talks about change in the curriculum so that language, I don't know, could be whatever, something small about a curriculum. Or we talk about the age of marriage. They want it to go down from 16 to 14 or whatever. And we talk about tiny issues that have no impact on the society. Or we talk about enforcing a code for people what to wear on a beach. But this is not a priority. Yes, it could be Islamic, but it's not a priority. And Maqasid al-Shari'ah allows us to face the challenges, because the Islamic agenda and the Muslim youth, if they do not face the right challenges, they will destroy themselves. And the movement, when it does not face the right challenges, it commits suicide. And that's basically what happened in many of the cases in the Arab world, where the movements did not fight the most danger and did not legislate for the most pressing issue and did not face the most important policy. And they did not work towards this. They ignored all the priorities that the Maqasid is telling them, darurat, before the hajiyat, before the tahsiniyat. So we go out in the streets where people are dying of hunger, and there are gangs and drugs and so on, and we're talking about beautifying the streets and, you know, whatever. Sisters, organizations, they are talking about, you know, how to make cakes and how to organize flowers. But the issues of Muslim women are much deeper than organizing flowers and making cakes and whatever. How to, have a colorful hijab. These could be tahsiniyat, this is nice, but this is not a priority. It's not a priority. Muslim women in this world do not have a very good status. We can all agree on that. I think tomorrow I will talk about women in the masjid. Alhamdulillah, here, mashallah. I mean, you have brothers and sisters in the masjid. I'm happy with that's one of the things that I'm happy with in Malaysia, where men and women are in the masjid. But you go to Muslim countries and in the West, and you don't find a mosque where a sister could pray. I was last month in London. We could not find a musalla where a sister could pray in London, England, right? Except I know them. I lived in London. There is one in Wimbledon, and there is one up there in whatever. Like, you count them on the hand. And hundreds of mosques where women are not allowed. There is a nice sign, men only, men's musalla. But that's unacceptable. You know, instead of facing this challenge and bringing the sisters back to the mosque, we are talking with the sisters about very small issues that are not the main issues in Islam. Maqasid al-Shari'ah organizes your mind so that you focus on the most essential. The most essential in Islam is what preserves life. Human life, the value of life, what preserves mind and intellect, not just sobriety and stuff, but also your mind, your intellect. This comes after life. What preserves dignity, what preserves family, what preserves property, in a major sense. And then we can talk about al-hajiyat, wa-tahsiniyat, and the adab, and all of what the scholars put under the other circles. The adab and the beautification are very important, but they are not essentials. A final thought here about Maqasid al-Shari'ah, they define for you the fixed from the variable. And it's very important when you face the challenges to define for yourself what is fixed and what is variable, what you are not going to give up, and what you can give up and change and adapt. I find a lot of the youth in front of their challenges, they lose the fixed values of Islam. They lose the immutable issues, the qat'ayat, the issues in Islam, the ahkam of Islam that are qat'i and non-negotiable, and so on, and they lose that because they didn't have an idea that separates the fixed from the variable, the immutables from the changeables. And you cannot really face your challenges if everything becomes a variable. It doesn't work. You lose your identity. You lose who you are as a Muslim. And you cannot face the challenges if everything becomes fixed. And there is a lot of rigidity here, and everything is fixed. So when everything is fixed, you cannot face challenges. You have to have room for creativity and maneuvering and so on. How can we differentiate between the fixed and the variables? What are the fixed things in Islam? And this is the final thought. The fixed things in Islam are, number one, the aqaid al-Islam, the aqidah. An aqidah is not philosophy of religion. It's not ilm al-kalam. Aqidah is Allah and the messengers and the books and the angels and the hereafter. And asma Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, al-Rahman, al-Rahim, al-Malik, al-Quddus. Aqidah is the faith framework for Muslims. This cannot be compromised. Then after the aqidah comes al-maqasid. For me, al-maqasid are fixed, are not variable. Yes, they can take different manifestations in different societies. But in Islam, justice is fixed. Justice is not negotiable. Mercy is not negotiable. Maslaha, common good, is not negotiable. You cannot define Islam in a way that betrays justice or maslaha or mercy or facilitation. You cannot endorse a view of Islam that makes people's lives hard or impossible or causes mischief or causes loss of life or dignity or family. These are fixed matters. The dealing with them is variable, but these are thawabit. You cannot compromise on the thawabit. And in fact, the thawabit reign over the mutaghayyirat. You know, the fixed matters govern over the variables and the tiny issues and the opinions. The opinions are not supposed to contradict the major values. Ibn al-Qayyim, and I always mention that almost in every lecture now, al-shari'atu, he says al-shari'atu adlun kulluha wa rahmatun kulluha wa hikmatun kulluha wa maslahatun kulluha. Sharia is all about justice, all about mercy, all about wisdom, and all about good. فكل مسألة خرجت بالشريعة عن العدل إلى الجوري فليست من الشريعة. Every opinion that takes Sharia from being about justice to being about injustice, then it's not Sharia. وعن الرحمة إلى ضدها, about cruelty instead of mercy, about mischief instead of good, about futility instead of wisdom, then it's not Sharia. He said فليست من الشريعة وإن أدخلت فيها بالتأويل. Even if somebody claims so according to an interpretation. So the thawabit, the fixed matters, allow us to interpret correctly. And the interpretation is not supposed to compromise the fixed matters. It's not supposed to compromise the values that we hold dear. And then there is another part that is fixed in the Sharia that is called the ta'abudiyat, the acts of worship, the rituals, al-sha'air, sha'airul Islam. What makes Muslims a Muslim? What makes a Muslim is the definition of right and wrong in terms of sin, in terms of al-dhunub. So for example, in Islam, zina is haram, theft is haram, murder is haram. Zina will never be halal one day, and we will not do any tajdeed in that. This is fixed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala defined what is haram in a very clear matter. And we are not supposed to make any tajdeed in that. This is, as I face my challenges as a Muslim, I have to know that this is fixed. And I should not allow anybody to change the definition of sin, the definition of haram. Riba is haram, etc. There are small things that are subject of differences of opinion. Yeah, this is fine. This is fiqh. All of them are correct, if you ask me. And we have Prof. Kamali here in his book on jurisprudence that the brothers mentioned. You will see so many opinions and so many ways to look at fiqh. So the tiny differences, all of them are fine, are good, are correct, inshallah. Or even if they are not correct, they are khata'ul ijtihad, you know, the ijtihad and you make a mistake, the Prophet ﷺ said, then you get a reward. You're still rewarded about that. But I'm talking about the major sha'a'ir, major rituals in Islam. Salah, five times, Ramadan, Al-Hajj, Zakah, etc. The family, ahkam al-usra in Islam. These things are fixed, right? But you can see that they are very few things. They are not so many. The fixed ahkam, sha'a'ir, the acts of worship in Islam are not so many. There are a number of rules that as a Muslim, in order to be ethical, in order to be pious, I go by these rules. Otherwise, everything is open for me to be creative. Everything is open for us to have differences of opinion, etc. So it is important for Maqasid al-Shari'ah to differentiate between what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has an objective for it to be fixed versus an objective to be variable. And these are things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a maqsid in. What are the maqasid of the fixed matters? It's a common manner and common ethics that we have as Muslims. We all pray in the same way. We all give zakah in the same way. We do hajj. We define morality in terms of relations and all of that in a particular way. These are immutable. These are non-changeable. And it's very important to keep that so that the challenges don't make us change Islam itself. There is something that the ulama call ma'alim al-shari'ah, the outline of the sharia, the framework of sharia. We should not compromise that as Muslims. We should not end up with something that is no longer sharia because we are trying to be creative and so on. So it is very important to keep the fixed matters, but to put the fixed matters in their place, very few fixed matters. So to sum up these thoughts, first of all, the importance of the youth, and repeating my advice to the youth to employ yourself, you and your friends, make a new organization, form a new coalition, do whatever that you feel is going to break the monopoly of the older ones on your work. Trust your mind and trust your thoughts, and know that the youth are the ones who pull the ummah up at any time since the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The other idea has to do, keep Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as your objective. Direct your life towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you do that, then this is the right maqasid thinking. Allah is my maqsood. Allah is my objective. Everything else is variable. Everything else is means. Also, in endorse and internalize the maqasid as akhlaq, as values. Justice is not just a system of government. It is my akhlaq, my way of dealing with others. Mercy, wisdom, the preservation of dignity, the preservation of family. All of these are values that I hold dear and I try to achieve in my life. Another idea has to do with ask why, and you have to have an answer for why. Sometimes the answer is that, well, it is a ibadah, this is how you can do it, that is fine, but not every answer is like that. And very few things in Islam are ibadat where you really don't have a rational answer for why, but most things in Islam and most things in life, in real life, have to be rationalized, have to have a why, and the why have to make sense. And the why will allow you to change the means in order to achieve the same ends. Another idea has to do with prioritize. Know the priorities and make sure that you put the most important things in Islam first, in your action and in your budget and in your time and in your effort, and the less important things less in your effort and budget and time. Make sure that you preserve the immutable issues in Islam. The definitions about morality and about action that is halal and that is haram in Islam, so that we preserve our Islam, the core of it. It is very important to preserve the core because that is the core that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala intended to be immutable, to be fixed. But everything else in the behaviors and in the relations and in the companies and in whatever you are trying to be creative with, be creative in any other form that is different from the basic akhlaq and the basic ahkam of Islam. So these are theoretical thoughts. I did not give many examples because I would like to go down here for the next session, and I want you to give me not theoretical questions. I teach a lecture on Maqasid al-Shari'ah tomorrow with ABIM. So if you want to ask about Imam al-Juwayni or Ghazali or al-Darrat wal-Hajiat wal-Tahsiniyat, come to this course. But the questions, I want them to be about challenges, not about fiqh. I don't want to give fatwa this morning. Just challenges, please. And I will try. I could be more challenged than you with the question. But we could try, inshallah, to find answers so that we have Islam as the guiding light, so that we can move in our journey to the final objective and the final maqsood, who is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قولوا قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم وجزاكم الله خير والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.